وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وآله وأصحابه وسلم وبعد. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، إن أصدق الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Brothers, we are grateful to Almighty Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We seek the blessings and mercy of Allah upon our noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his household, upon his companions, and on all those that are following the guidance of Nabiyuna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam till the last day. So today being the sixth day of Ramadan, 1445 years after the hijrah of our noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Mecca to Medina, which is equivalent to the 17th of March 2024 Christian era. We shall continue bi'idhnillahi ta'ala with the commentary or explanation briefly, based on the level of our capability, on Surah Yusuf, which we have actually started with the introduction of this noble chapter of the Quran last year, and which yesterday we started with the first verse of Surah Yusuf. So, and like I mentioned yesterday, this year, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we'll always be starting the class with a kind of questions and answers before we go into the detail of whatever we are going to take of the commentary. So today, the first question, or maybe the question for today, still is going to be on the introductory aspects, which we explained last year. So during the course of introduction to Surah Yusuf last year, I actually stated that this chapter will be telling us about the comprehensive story of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. And we also stated that it is always a very important quality of the one that is to narrate a story, to narrate the story nicely in such a way that it will be clearly understood by those that will be listening to the story, or those that will be reading to the story. And there is no doubt that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the best when it comes to, you know, giving speech. There is none that can be compared to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in terms of giving speech, or even in everything that has to do with the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why we have the best form of a pattern of a narrating story in this chapter as well. So we stated that last year that the whole story, or the whole chapter, will be divided into three parts. So with regards to the story of Nabiullahi Yusuf. So then the question is, what are the parts that we said the story will be divided into, or at least the chapter will be divided into, in terms of you know, the narration of the stories of Nabiullahi Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. Yes, I'm sure that our noble reciter was part of the class last year. So yes, and I'm also sure that most of our professors here were also part of the class last year. So, and the coordinator also was part of the class. So any response to that?
I think I can't say exactly, but I think there are four different parts.
So four different parts.
I might be wrong.
That's his response. If we have a contradictory response, we can also give ours. So the first part will be
The part where he started the journey, where he narrated the story of the dream to his father.
Then the second part,
when he was sold into slavery.
Then the third part,
in age Misr.
Then the fourth part,
prison.
Okay.
The fifth part has to be after he hung.
After he united with his family.
He's still four, but you added one, making five.
If he stopped there, the
story is not complete.
So actually, we stated last year that the whole story will be divided into three parts. So we have three different episodes. So the first part, that will be the introductory part, introduction to the story. We all know, whenever anyone is given a story, so there will always be introduction to the story. The story will not be complete, or it will not be interesting, if the story comes without an introduction. Even in our local language, if one is going to narrate a story, there will be introduction. Even in English, when one is going to narrate a story, he will not just go directly into the story. There will be introduction to the story. At least, there will be story. Once upon a time. So then, before going into the details of the story, so also in this chapter we have the introduction to the story of Nabiullahi Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. So also we have the main body of the story. So the main body of the story is the one that we said will be divided into six different scenes. I hope that was the part he was trying to recall. Then he grouped into four and the prof added a part. So we actually have six parts there. We have six different scenes. The first one is the narration of the story to his father and the advice from the father to Nabiullahi Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. So the second part will be the relationship of Nabiullah Yusuf with his brothers alayhi salatu wassalam. So, and the third part will now be the life of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam in the palace of Al-Aziz. So the one that bought Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam. So, and the fourth part will now be the life of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam in prison. So, and the fifth part will now be, you know, the dream of the king and the interpretation of the dream which Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam offered. And, you know, the life of Nabiullah Yusuf around that. And the last part will now be the reunion of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wassalam with his brothers. So then we now have the conclusion of the story. Those are the parts which we mentioned last year. I hope we can recall now. Lars sisters. So still we are on the introduction to the story of Nabiullah Yusuf, and we actually stated then that last year that the first three verses of this noble surah is, you know, are going to be talking about the introduction to the story of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So that means from the verse which we took yesterday to the third verse, I hope we'll be able to get to the third verse today. So all those verses will be, you know, talking about the introduction to the story of Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. And that is why we'll see that from among all we explained yesterday, there was hardly any, you know, thing regarding Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam's life specifically. Rather, we only talked about, you know, the Quran, the revelation of the Quran, the composition of the Quran with regards to, you know, the huruf of Arabic, letters. So, and also we stated the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam with regards to the honor bestowed on Nabiullah Yusuf alayhi salatu wasalam. So, and the fact that the Quran, which is sent to our noble prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is a clear book, a book that is obvious, that, you know, does not contain any form of ambiguity. So except one does not know. As long as one is aware of it, there is no any form of ambiguity in the Quran. So today, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we are going to continue from where we stopped that yesterday. And that is, going by the second verse where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين. نعم.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم إنا أنزلناه قرآنا عربيا لعلكم تعقلون نحن نقص عليك أحسن القصص بما أوحينا إليك هذا القرآن وإن كنت من قبله لمن الغافلين.
نعم جزاكم الله خيرا. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to our noble prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that إِنَّا verily we أَنزَلْنَاهُ Quran and Arabiya, we reveal unto you that book which is mentioned in the first verse. So such that book, the Quran itself, such that it is Quran and in Arabic language, Quran and Arabiya. So we reveal that book to you such that the book is Quran and in form of Arabic language. La'allakum ta'aqilun, so that you people will understand, so that you people will have a clear of understanding of the Quran. So now we go into the explanation of this particular verse. So we see that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started this verse with inna. So that's a form of stress, that verily there is no doubt that we reveal the Quran. There is no doubt that we were the one that, revealed the Quran to you, O the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So, there are a lot of things we have to note here. And that is the fact that the Quran is a revelation from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is no anyone that is capable of revealing the Quran other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is capable of revealing the Quran. The only thing we can do as human is to read, to recite the Quran. to read, to understand the Quran, or to explain the Quran based on the explanation of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So that means it will be wrong for anyone to say that I revealed the Quran. It is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is capable of revealing the Quran. In fact, it is Allah indeed that revealed the Quran. So even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is not capable of revealing the Quran to himself. Malak Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam is not capable of revealing the Quran to the noble Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But it is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that revealed the Quran. So there is a point we have to note here. And that point is a kind of common language that people use back home, especially when it comes to, you know, supplication, congregational supplication, so to say. We all know the one we do, or that, let me not say the one we do, the one they do, because we are not doing what they do, that one person will request, you know, for scholars to come and supplicate in his home or in his office or, you know, at a particular place. And such that that supplication will be accompanied by recitation of the Quran. So, in this case now, people will now say, we revealed the Quran, or we descend the Quran, so to say, in the local language, aso Quran kale, or afeso Quran kale. So, this is a statement that is noteworthy. This is not something that is a quality of human. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is capable of revealing the Quran. Even though what they mean is that they recite the Quran. And in fact, they used to explain that the origin of that particular word comes from the fact that in the olden days before, the Quran, the Mushaf we're having today, is not so common. So perhaps in a particular city, or maybe in a particular state, maybe it is only one. I can recall that, you know, some of our fathers narrated to us that before, the first imam in, you know, our community, so used to go to Ilorin on a weekly basis, then he would come back for the purpose of khutbah of Jum'ah. So he would have to go there to learn the khutbah that will be delivered in the coming Jum'ah, before the Jum'ah. So once that Jum'ah is over, then you have to go there again to learn that before coming back. You know, the implication is the religion itself was new at the time, and the knowledge was also not as spread as this at the time. So, and not everyone, you know, is having access to the materials that explain the deen, especially the Quran. In fact, this is something that is popular that all of us might have heard about before, that before the coming of Sheikh Alim to Ilorin. So the Quran they were having in Ilorin then was incomplete. So it was the one that brought the complete Quran. So at that time, when the Quran they were having was not even complete, perhaps they have only one or maybe two, not very many. So they used to secure the Quran they have in such a way that they have a bag. They have a bag specifically for the Quran. So the Quran will be stored in the bag and it will be, you know, hang. So whenever they are going to recite the Quran, then it's going to be removed from hanger, and you know, it will now be distributed. That is how the language is come about, that after so Quranically, meaning that it has to be removed from the hanger.
Inna anzalnahu Quranan Arabiya.
I think it's fine, because I'm also coming into that although today. So that is part of things we have to note. The fact that that word, even though at the beginning they used it for a different purpose, but the fact that it coincides with, you know, something that is very important in the deen, which is revelation, and which we know it only belongs to Allah, then we have to be careful when it comes to the use of that word, that we reveal the Quran, or we descend the Quran, or whatever. So it is only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that is capable of doing that. That is not to say that I am approving, or I am saying that that kind of prayer that people do, that it is, you know, it is okay or it is permissible. No, I'm only referring to, you know, that particular statement that they used to make. Because even the prayer itself has a lot of things that scholars have, you know, spoken about. One of which is the fact that people recite the Quran, you know, together in chorus. This one will be Muslim. Everyone will be, without anyone listening to the Quran. And the Quran is a book that whenever it is being recited, people are supposed to listen to it. Quran is not a book that people recite together in chorus. Quran is not a book that people, you know, recite together as if we are Muslim. This is not supposed to be, unless it is a case whereby, you know, we are learning the Quran. So that's why I said, I will also want to come into that, because by the time we also turn into that, and when it is not for the purpose of learning, but just for the purpose of the melody, then that becomes, you know, a different thing also. So it's better we allow the reciter to, you know, recite. If it is, if the case is we want to learn the recitation together, then we can all recite. But other than the fact that we want to learn the recitation together just for the sake of the melody, then it is something we have to, you know, note. So now, the first word there, inna, like we have interpreted, it means verily we. So who is we here? That's a question to us. Who is we in this verse?
Nobody except Allah.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is we. But we know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is only one. Right? But Allah is using we. And in our local language, they will say Opoenya. Nije awade. So one person cannot just say yes, Opoenya nije jama. That's a kind of mixture. So one person cannot say we. You have to say I, not we. So, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is using we here. So, scholars will always say, this is a statement, you know, of pride. We all know this. If one person is speaking, and you use we for yourself, it is nothing but a statement of pride. We are not going to give you. That means you have attached a particular level of importance to yourself. Of course, this is something that is wrong for human. But for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that has that quality of pride itself. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that has that quality of pride. In fact, in authentic hadith, it is, you know, it is reported that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the external cloth, the rida, like, you know, of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is that kibr, pride itself. So which we are not expected to share with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So if I am the type that I am arrogant, if you are the type that you are arrogant, Prof, if you are arrogant, then you have to stop that. I have to stop that. We have to stop that. Yes, Abu Abdullah, if you are arrogant, you are looking at Prof, because I just pointed to him. Then he was smiling. just like me, that I'm not saying he's arrogant. So I don't even want us to elongate this, because I want us to finish this verse, and you know, looking at the time there. So anyway, pride itself is a quality of our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's a quality of our Lord subhanahu wa ta'ala, and not for us. So as human, we are not expected to exhibit an atom of pride. An atom of pride. It is authentically reported in the hadith narrated by Al-Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi, from the authority of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, that he said that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, la yadkhulul jannah, that he will not enter into Jannah, he will not be admitted into paradise. Who is that person? Man kana fi qalbihi mithqala dharra min al-kibr. Anyone that is having an atom of pride in his heart will not be admitted into Jannah. An atom of pride, when you have it in your heart, then that will prevent you from going into Jannah. So if we are to check ourselves today, maybe we can find any from among us that is not arrogant today. Maybe it's possible, maybe it's not possible. Sometimes we do, sometimes we don't do. So, but we have to stop this, because this is something that we are not expected to do in any case, because the prophet is saying, whosoever is having an atom of arrogance in his heart will not be admitted into Jannah. Then a companion asked the prophet, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that a man would like to wear a very good, nice cloth and a very nice shoe. So, what about that? Because usually when people mention arrogance, we think of all these worldly things, like he's coming with his car because he wants us to know that he's having. What is your problem with that? It is never haram for him to use a nice car. My professor will say Kia money. You always mention Kia money. You know, it is never a bad thing for you to use good cloth. Of course, not out of extravagancy. No. Because so the way people do things today also, sometimes it goes beyond extreme. I was discussing with some brothers some other time. I think Abu Rumaisor was there. I was watching a particular video and they were doing body count. And, you know, when I was hearing the prices of the items they were wearing, I was like, is this possible? Is this actually possible? Because for us that we just go to market, we all know our style. Then at a particular time, Prof was telling me also that there was a cloth he bought at that place. We used to buy cloth. Then he bought it at a particular price. Then he just went to Walmart one day and he saw the same kind of cloth. When he priced that same kind of cloth, I think he mentioned around 600,000 won, if I'm not mistaken, Prof. So, and you'll be surprised, it's just t-shirt. Just t-shirt. But we all know t-shirt and t-shirt are not same. T-shirts and t-shirt are not same.
Capital and small letter.
Anyway, the most important point here is, it is not illegal, it is not haram to use a good cloth, to use nice shoes. You know, all those things that are permissible. No, those are not what we call arrogance in Islam. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam then told him that kibr itself, arrogance that we are saying itself, has to do with bafar al-haq, rejecting the truth. When people tell you the truth, then you feel pompous, with that truth. You go against the truth. You refuse to accept the truth. That is arrogance. Even if you are wearing rag, you only have a shoe, not even a pair of shoes, and you are rejecting the truth, then you are arrogant. So then you are arrogant. This is something that is expected to be avoided. This is something that when you have it, it will prevent you from going into Jannah. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam continued by saying, "Wa ghamtu an-nas," and also disdaining people, commonizing people, overlooking people as if they worth nothing, as if people are worthless. You think you are the only one that you are there and no one else is there. When you have this quality in you, you are arrogant. When you think you are the only one, you think other people are useless. You think other people are valueless. Then you should know that you yourself are the useless one. You should know that you are the valueless. Why? Because in the day of Qiyamah, that will prevent you from going into Jannah. And when people will be entering into paradise, you're being prevented from entering into paradise. Then are you not worthless? You're indeed worthless. So when you are the type that you commonize people, you think when you are there, no one else is there, then you should know that you are arrogant. Alhamdulillah, we are blessed with nice communities. Nice community in such a way that even those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed them in a very, high position, do not even posit themselves as if they are something. We are seated together. We have them around, all around us. When we are eating, we joke, we, you know, nothing is as if we are all age mates. Nobody cares. So this is something that should be encouraged. And this means that we are not actually commonizing ourselves, so to say. This means we value ourselves. We don't think others are worthless. If you are the type that you always attach importance, a specific importance to yourself, which you think that makes you better than others, and you think others are worthless, then you should know that you are arrogant. You should know that that quality itself is enough to prevent you from going into Jannah. So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, "Inna." This is a statement of pride, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that verily do this. It is Allah. And scholars will always say, whenever Allah uses this kind of statement, that inna, this is a kind of statement that is used by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give importance to something that is to be mentioned. It is not, because we are saying that pride is a quality of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that does not mean that the use of inna here is for Allah to show us that He is greater. Already Allah is greater, there is no doubt. There is no need for even showing that, but to show clearly the importance attached to that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to mention, then that will lead to the use of this kind of statement as explained by scholars. So then Allah said, "Inna anzalnahu," we are the one that revealed it, and that is the Quran. We are the one that revealed the book, the Quran. We revealed the Quran. So this statement, this verb used here is anzala. In some, you know, verses in the Quran, we have this used together with the Quran. Sometimes we have nazala used together with the Quran. Like Allah is saying in this chapter, in this verse, inna anzalnahu Quranan Arabiya. The verse that all of us know, Suratul Qadr. Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. The verse in another chapter in Surah Dukhan, inna anzalnahu fi laylatin mubarakah. So in some other, you know, verses of the Quran, we have nazala. Like Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying in Surah Al-Insan, inna nahnu nazzalna alayka al-Qur'ana tanzila. So sometimes we have nazzala being used, sometimes we have anzala being used. Are these two words same? Are these two verbs same? Scholars explain that they are not same. They are not same. So then, what is the meaning of the first one, and what is the meaning of the second one? So, when anzala is used, of course, generally both of them means something that is revealed. And we know for us to say something is revealed, that means that is elevated already. For example, we say rain is falling. That means rain is coming from up. So same when we say the Quran is revealed, that means it's coming from a higher place. And that is also giving importance to that which is to be mentioned. Because we know something will only come from higher place, that which is hallowed. Something that is honorable, we place it at high position. If we are to sit in a group like this and we have perhaps the president here, the president seat or presidential seat will be different from, you know, my own seat. It will be different from that of our reciter. It will be different from that of other people. So, if we have in a class, we have students, we have teachers. Student seats will be similar, but that of teacher will not be the same as that of student. We all know when we were in primary school, secondary school, you know, our desk perhaps we sit in three, in twos, in fours, or whatever. But our teacher will have one big table. Even though the situation sometimes is upside down now, we have in some places that even teachers are not having seats. Subhanallah. This is something that Allah should assist us on. Anyway, so when this kind of statement is used, it is to show importance to that which is to be mentioned. Now the verb anzala, means that that which is to be mentioned, like in this case now, when it is mentioned together with the Quran, it means it is revealed once. That the Quran is revealed once. Then when it is mentioned as nazala, then it means it is revealed in portions, bit by bit. So here now, inna anzalnahu, that means we revealed it, the Quran, once. Then when it is mentioned that nazala, nazalna, and the way it is used,
nahnu nazalna dhikra,
then we revealed, you know, the remembrance. So it means it is revealed in portions, bit by bit. So how do we see this? In Surah An-Nisa, in verse 136. So perhaps you read that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu, aminu billah. Surah An-Nisa. We cannot open our Quran into Surah An-Nisa 136.
أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم يا أيها الذين آمنوا آمنوا بالله ورسوله والكتاب الذي نزل على رسوله والكتاب الذي أنزل من قبل ومن يكفر بالله وملائكته وكتبه ورسله واليوم الآخر فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا بَعِيدًا.
Even though I also overlook some things, anyway, yeah, that's not so important now. So anyway, so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, oh you who believe, aminu billah, you believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wa rasuli, and also believe in the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah said what?
وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي نَزَّلَ عَلَىٰ رَسُولِهِ.
And the book that is revealed to the prophet, to the messenger. So the book here, we have the verb here, نَزَّلَ. So scholars say this is the Quran. This is the Quran, because the Quran, and this verse clearly differentiate between the Quran and other previous revelation. Because the Quran here, it means that Allah revealed the Quran in, you know, portions, bit by bit, bit by bit. Then Allah said again,
وَالْكِتَابِ الَّذِي أَنزَلَ مِن قَبْلِ.
And the books that were revealed before the Quran, before this generation. So those other books, Allah used أَنزَلَ for them. That means all other revelations before the Quran, they were all revealed at once. I don't mean that the Torah, the Injil, the all those other books were revealed together at once. But what I mean is, any book given to any prophet, any messenger before the prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that book completely will be revealed at once. Like a Torah now, given to Musa, was revealed at once. Jumlatan wahida, just at once. Not like in the case of the Quran, that when an event occurs, Allah revealed a verse, revealed a chapter, revealed this, revealed that. The same thing goes to Injil. So Allah revealed all those books at once, but for the Quran, it was revealed bit by bit. Now one will have a kind of confusion here, or a kind of confusion might come here, that okay, if that means that those other books were revealed at once, and the Quran, we are saying it's revealed bit by bit based on the fact that Allah used nazala for Quran here. What about like in this verse and verses like this, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying inna anzalnahu, that we revealed the Quran once also. How do we, you know, reconcile between this? So scholar said the revelation of the Quran is in two forms. The first one is the revelation from Lawh al-Mahfuz to the sky that is close to the earth. So when the Quran was revealed to Baitul Izzah, so that is the one that is mentioned when we have the Quran being revealed together. So, like the one that we have in Surah Al-Qadr, Inna anzalnahu fi laylatil qadr. Like in the case of the month of Ramadan, that Allah is saying شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن. So that means the revelation of the Quran from Lawh al-Mahfuz to, you know, the Baytul Izzah, to the sky that is the sama, that is that of this world, the sama close to this world. So then, after that, then Allah is now revealing the Quran in bits, in portions to the Prophet, such that when an event occurs, then a verse will be, you know, given to the Prophet by sent by Malakul Jibril alayhi salatu wasalam, bit by bit. I hope we understand this.
Yeah.
So that's the difference between Anzala, Nazala. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say, Quran and Arabiya, we reveal the book such that that book is Quran. And what is Quran? Quran is something that is put together, something that is, you know, meant to be collective, something that is brought together. We have things in parts, then brought together as one. That is Quran. Scholars also explain that something that is meant to be recited consistently, something that is meant to be recited consistently, is the Quran. And we all know, right now, we are just taking a kind of, commentary. I don't want to call it commentary. If there is a language we can use below commentary, then we should say that is what we are doing presently. Now, in how many other places are people sitting like this, doing the same thing like this simultaneously? In how many places are people sitting, you know, reciting the Quran right now? In how many places people are even praying, observing Salatul Fajr, reciting the Quran, Salatul Dhuhr, Salatul Asr, or whatever Salat they are observing? So Quran is something that is meant to be recited. So this is also a pointer to the fact that all of us, that we are Muslims, perhaps we all have copies of Quran at home, but sometimes we keep that just for decoration, and nothing more. This is going to be an admonition to us that Quran is not a book that is meant for decoration. It is a book that is meant to be recited. In fact, some scholars will say when you have more than a copy of Quran and you have them at home, you have to recite every copy daily. Some scholars will say that. You know? So, that is to tell us that Quran is not just something, a book that we just keep, just for keeping's sake. It is a book that is meant to be recited. When we just keep it there, just for decoration, we clean it, then there is a problem. There is one popular story that people do say, a man visited a home of another man. The man that visited the home of the other one is the imam. So, you know, upon visiting the home, there was a particular amount of money which was kept. So he felt like the money was not in a safe place, you know. Then he decided to keep the money inside the Quran there. So after, when he left, the owner of the money was searching for the money. That, where is my money? I kept it. Why? How? They could not find it. And they knew there was no anyone that visited except
the imam.
So the imam was consulted. You know, after a long while, that we kept, you know, a particular amount of money, we could not find it. And like, it took, you know, it took a long period, not just one day, not even months, before they summoned the courage to meet with the imam that, how come? We did not have any other person that visited. We tried to reason. We do not want to come to you, but we cannot just, do away with our conscience, because you were the one that came. How come? Then the imam was like surprised that I just kept your money in your home. So you mean the Quran you have in your home? So you mean you just keep it just like that for months? You did not even bother to touch the Quran because the money was just inside the Quran. You know, sometimes we do this. We keep Quran at home, but just for keeping sake. Sometimes when we discover that it is becoming dusty, we try to dust it out, and that's all. We clean it and put it there again. In fact, some people have a prayer portion, we call it, or prayer, not prayer room. They have a particular portion of their home where they will be praying mat. So at that portion, they will place the Quran. You know, sometimes there is this Turarimuta, what are they calling it? This, you know, we all know this. Yes. Yeah. So, you know, they place all those kind of incandescent saints there, you know, subha and all this, they put it there. So that when they want to pray, in fact, they even kindle, you know, the saints, so that the jinns will go away. But the Quran is there. As if the Quran there, keeping it there, as if that is going to make the prayer, you know, accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The Quran is not meant for just skipping there. It is meant for, you know, recitation. It is meant for us to be reciting, not just keeping there. So, Quran is a book that is meant to be recited. Then, Arabiya. So, Allah revealed the Quran in Arabic language. In Arabic language. Best language. Best language so far. As explained by scholars. A lot of things are there in Arabic language, that will always be pointing to the fact that, no, this language is indeed the best. Just imagine an example of Anzala, not Zala, that we have just said now. How many languages are having, you know, this kind of things in them? So, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the Quran to the best prophet and in the best language, which is Arabic language. Yes, our languages are also good, but then Arabic language is the best language, as explained by scholars. So, this is a pointer to remind all of us of how important it is for us to learn the Quran, and not just the Quran, also Arabic language, because we would not have understood the Quran without Arabic language. It will not be possible. One can only understand the Quran if one understands the language of the Quran. So, in fact, the language of the Quran is Arabic. The language of Islam is Arabic, and not any other language. It is not possible that one wants to pray, he wants to observe Salat al-Fajr, then he will say, Allah is great. In the name of Allah, the glorious, the most glorious, or the most beneficent, the most merciful. And he keeps all praises due to Allah. You know, even it will not be sweet. So, it is only in Arabic. It has to be in Arabic. So, that means all of us, we have to strive to understand the language of the Quran. Then, لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ, so that you will understand. This is done so that you will understand, so that you will have understanding. So, if one is interested in having understanding, even of this world, then let that person learn the Quran. If you learn the Quran, then you will understand this word. When you learn the Quran, definitely, you will have perfect understanding of this word. Now, going back to this Quran in Arabiya, that the Quran is revealed in Arabic language, there is something very important that we have to note here also, that a book will only be Quran if that Quran is in Arabic language. Because Allah said, "Inna anzalnahu Qur'anan Arabiya." So, Quran will be Quran if it is in the language of Quran, Arabic language. So, if it is not in Arabic language, then it is not Quran. It can only be translated Quran, but not Quran. So, Quran has to be in Arabic. Quran has to be in Arabic. So, also pointing again to the fact that it is important for us to learn Arabic language. If one is having translated Quran, you read translated Quran, yes, you have some understanding. But then, it is very, very likely that you have a lot of confusions. It is very, very likely that you have a lot of confusions. So, if you want to avoid that, you need to understand the language of the Quran, which is Arabic language. So, there is something that is noteworthy here. And that is a ruling that scholars do give in respect of the verse in Surah Al-Waqi'ah, that innahu la Qur'anun kareem fi kitabin maknun la yamassuhu illa al-mutahharun. So that verily this that book is the Quran that is, you know, honored. It is a glorious Quran that is in a protected book, and that's such that no one should touch that book, or no one can touch that book except the one that is pure, the one that is clean. So even those scholars who explain that directly this verse is referring to the fact that there is no any evil spirit, no any shayateen, no any other than the angels that, you know, have the, you know, permission to touch the Quran, and that even that is referring to the Quran in Lawhil Mahfuz. And we know all the malaika, they are indeed pure, like we explained yesterday, that the iman of malaika is always constant, they are always at a constant state of iman. So now, but then scholars do adapt this same verse to mean that one cannot touch the Quran if one is in a state of impurity. If one is in a state of impurity, then it is not permissible for one to touch the Quran. In fact, a lot of scholars even explain it up to the extent that when you do not have ablution, when you are not in a state of ablution, then that you cannot touch the Quran. Not just ordinary impurity, like when you are, you know, when you have engaged in sexual intercourse or whatever. Not that alone. Some scholars explain to the extent, in fact, a lot of scholars, that you have to be in a state of ablution before touching the Quran. Now, this is one part. Then another part now is that the non-Muslims, this is a very popular ruling, that non-Muslims cannot touch the Quran. When you are holding the Quran now, and perhaps a pastor or a reverend or an idol worshiper or something comes to you, and you know, wants to collect the Quran from you, that let me see that book. You say no, you cannot touch, because you are not pure. Because the non-believers, the idol worshippers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says they are, you know, impure. They are najas. So generally, the non-Muslims cannot touch the Quran. But then, remember, I just mentioned the fact that Quran will only be Quran if it is in what?
Arabic.
In Arabic. So when it is not in Arabic language, then it is no longer Quran. It is only translated Quran. So that is why scholars will explain that if it is translated Quran and that does not contain Arabic text, then in that case, it is permissible for non-Muslim to touch that. They can read that. But the Quran in Arabic, it cannot be touched by non-Muslims. So, however, it should be noted that this is as long as we have the capability to prevent that. Because like now, a non-Muslim can decide to buy the Quran, order it online. They will not ask that, are you a Muslim or you are not a Muslim before, you know. And that's, and when he buys that, you cannot prevent him from doing it, especially when you are not, you know, in an Islamic country. You are in a country like this, a non-Muslim is holding Quran. He said, why will you be holding that? You have to give it to me. When he bought it with his money, then a tenu bawa. So one has to know that is as long as one is having the capability. So if it is now, for some of us, sometimes we feel like someone is so good to us and he's a non-Muslim. He has been so good to us and we do not see a way of, you know, benefiting him. The only thing we see we can use in benefiting him is to preach to him. We want to preach Islam to him. And we know that he's someone that is also knowledgeable, at least based on the knowledge of this world. Perhaps a professor. Many of our professors here are not Muslims. Maybe even there is no any of our professors that is a Muslim. Not even many. I do not know of any of our professors that is a Muslim here. Apart from our professors, not our professor, not our home-based professor. I mean, those professors. So now we may feel like they are so good to us, they have you know, been a source for us to come to this place to learn. And, you know, so many things they have done to us. We feel like the best thing we can do to them is to preach to them. And sometimes we feel like we are not in a position to tell them that, oh, professor, please accept Islam. Embrace the fact that La ilaha illallah. Accept that there is no deity worthy of worship except Allah. Maybe because we fear that once we say that, perhaps we are preparing our visa back to anyway, not even our visa. So we are preparing our exit path back home or something. We may fear that. Then sometimes we feel like, okay, the best thing we can do to them is when we give them a book, at least they will read that. The fact that they read that, they will understand the message that we are trying to pass across, and that will not lead to any problem. So we feel like we want to present them with Quran. Then in this case, if it is a translated one without Arabic text, then perhaps this will be permissible. But, you know, Quran, Arabiya, this is absolutely not permissible. So, may Allah assist us. So, and the purpose of the revelation of the Quran is لَعَلَّكُمْ تَعْقِلُونَ, so that we will be able to understand, so that we can reflect. Anyone that is, you know, having the knowledge of the Quran, being it the memorization of the Quran, being able to read the Quran, and is reading the Quran itself, acting based on the teachings of the Quran, understanding the Quran, any of this, you have the knowledge, then you will definitely be among people of understanding. Because there are a lot of things, you know, pointing to understanding in the Quran. One will not have, you know, understand the Quran except one is among the knowledgeable people. We all know the popular notion that people do say when we are in universities, you know, in our bachelor's days, people always say those tabligh afar, they are usually very, very good when it comes to, you know, understanding the concept of what we are learning in university. They are so good. Those afar, they are so good. Say that all those people that that learn Quran, they are excellent. They are this, they are that. Yes, how wouldn't it be? How wouldn't it be? If one can have knowledge to understand the Quran, then other things would definitely be easy. You know, in the longest verse in the Quran, in the second to the last page of Surah Al-Baqarah, at the last part, Allah is saying, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهِ فَيُعَلِّمُكُمُ اللَّهِ. When you fear Allah, then Allah is going to teach you. All you need to do is to fear Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself is going to teach you. So a lot of things are there in the Quran that to make one to understand, there is no doubt. So brothers, and perhaps the sisters that may be listening to us, if we want our memory to remain alive throughout our life, then we should learn Quran. I usually give an instance of Ababa that is widely known to all of us. I will not want to mention name now, but we might have known the Baba that I'm referring to. You know, spending 100 and something years in the world, and yet whenever he's speaking like this, you cannot just imagine if there is anything happening to that has happened to his memory. Why? Because of the knowledge of the Quran. So some people, once they are approaching 70 like this or 80, it becomes a situation whereby I'm also taking note of time. It becomes a situation whereby you tell them A, they will be responding with Z. Say, Kwese babana, dementia ni. Kwese babana, agbati deni. But then, when you are the type that you understand the Quran, you learn Quran, your memory will remain alive as long as you are living in this world. Your memory will remain perfect. You wouldn't have any problem with your memory. So, anyway, my research is it has to do with dementia. So, but then, you know, the science are trying to find the solution, you know, to dementia. And the best solution, even though I don't know how possible it will be for me to be able to, you know, write something on that, but the perfect solution to dementia is learning the Quran. When you learn the Quran, your memory will remain alive as long as you are living. As long as you are living. How won't you understand the Quran? أَفَلَا يَنْظُرُونَ إِلَى الْإِبِلِ كَيْفَ خُلِقَتْ وَإِلَى السَّمَاءِ كَيْفَ رُفِعَتْ وَإِلَى الْجِبَالِ كَيْفَ نُصِبَتْ وَإِلَى الْأَرْضِ كَيْفَ سُطِحَتْ. Just look at all these kind of statements. A lot of things are there in the Quran that will point you to understanding. Allah will give you a lot of parables and tell you at the end, don't you understand? Don't you see? Don't you this? Don't you that? So Quran is a book revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Arabic language, so that we will understand. So we are going to stop here today. I thought we'll be able to take it up to the third verse. I'm sorry. Next week, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala, we are going to continue from here, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts our ibadah in this blessed month of Ramadan. May Allah forgive our shortcoming. Whatever I've said that is right is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the wrongs from among what I've said are just my personal misdeed and perhaps from the whispering of shaitan. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive us and take that away from our hearts. I pray Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our parents and accept them as faithful servants. Allahumma rabbana atina fi dunya hasana وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على آل إبراهيم في العالمين إنك حميد مجيد سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك